early winter weather here. The reason we can tell it's winter is because this color in the sky at sunset, and you know, sun comes down a little earlier, but that's it. So we're happy you're here. You got here before El Nino hit, so it's still some nice days. And if there's anything I can do for you while you're here, you want to see anything you've heard about and haven't seen, let me know, and I'll take care of you individually. So thank you very much for coming. Have a good day.
We have 3 days. Each day has a theme. Today's theme is going to be set up by our keynote speaker, Lev Manovic from CCNY, City College of New York.
I always tell PR people at my university that we have to read a name, because nobody can get the name. It's a graduate center, which is a PhD giving part of City University of New York. And I'm also a research scientist at UCSD, working at Colette Utah.
CCNY, but CUNY.
Yeah, CCT. What you said sounds more like TV station, I think.
NY1. Okay, so today's sessions, we're going to have Lev's keynote about media and culture, and we'll see what he wants to talk to us about. And then we'll have a discussion and presentations about ultra-high def and high dynamic range. As Natalie mentioned, there'll be demonstrations in the V room next door that will show very high quality, high dynamic range on different types of displays with different types of content, as well as an underwater microscopy demonstrations from Jules Jaffe here on the faculty and his team. This afternoon, we'll take up new content in new forms and preservation, and finish with a showcase of 4K content. Tomorrow, we're going to dig into immersive video and immersive audio and network collaboration. And then on Friday, we'll look at cyber infrastructure. And we have a very strong program on Friday for how do we make the plumbing for all this work in real life. And so there's receptions every evening. One of the goals of CineGrid is to provide a forum for people to meet each other, human to human. And I encourage you to sit with people you don't know at lunch and at dinner, and learn about what's happening around the world. And with that, I've stalled long enough. Here you go.
So welcome, everybody, and to our friends from Seoul. Annyeonghaseyo, kamsahamnida, arasayo, fighting. Well, maybe some of you guys don't know, but my wife is a composer from Seoul, so we go over every year. And I think it was in Seoul, like maybe, I don't know, maybe 2005, when I was a curator for Media City Seoul. You know, I saw like first, like, you know, I think it was 1K or 2K, kind of live video, right, live television on a mobile phone. And if you want to know, right, you know, the future of visual media, you know, just go to Asia once in a while, you know. I mean, you can come to Colette Utah, where you're going to see future, which is 20 years from now, or you can go to Asia, where you'll see future like 5 to 7 years from now. Not everybody probably knows, but the social media, you know, the messaging, you know, the sharing, all start in Asia about 5 years before it actually took off here. So Lauren called me. He said, Lev, I want you to come and talk at CineGrid. I said, why? He said, well, you know, we've been doing a fantastic job for a number of years here, talking about and exchanging ideas and collaborating in the area, in the areas which are really cutting edge, right? So 2K, now 4K and beyond, optical networks, and very high fidelity image. But meanwhile, as you know, a kind of social media revolution took place, right? So 1.5 billion people, or 2 billion people probably using social media, you know, and we now have 1.5 billion photographers, right? And for the critics, So I want you to talk about social image because we want to start thinking about, let's say, the small screen as a part of CineGrid sort of paradigm. So that's why I title my talk Grab Social Image. You can find our tools. So I represent Software Studies Initiative, which is the lab, which we started at Collective Tool in 2007 to study specifically visual social media. And you can find our publications, free tools, and download over 1,300 high-resolution visualizations at Flickr. Well, you know these numbers, but just to remind you, this is data from 2015. So 300 million photos are shared on Facebook every day, about 80 million on Instagram, about 430 hours of video, 1 billion YouTube mobile video views, and what's interesting is that the average YouTube mobile session, which is what people, right, watching YouTube on the phone, is about 40 minutes long. So this is massive. And luckily, right, the development of computer tools, super visualization systems, such as the beautiful walls that you see in this building, machine learning and so on, now allows us to study large parts of this visual social media to understand what people share, how we share, what kind of images we take, and to kind of try to make some sense of this amazing user-generated visual universe. So let's say this is some random Instagram images from Tokyo. This is over 3,000 selfies, which we collected for our projects. And then, of course, we can measure these images using computers. So in this case, for example, we're measuring face properties of selfies we collected on Instagram from different cities, using kind of open source face recognition software. And then we can use the amazing, right, futuristic super visualization displays, such as, again, the wall, right, such as the wall in the next room, to visualize them and make sense of them the way we normally visualize numbers. Now, our work is a part of a huge, huge development, which is a whole set of new research fields that use big cultural and social data, of course, social media and user-generated content, and also digitized cultural heritage, but also satellite data, mobile phone data, let's say the bike paths, right, and so on, to study social, economic, and cultural patterns and cultural histories. Right? So if 100 years ago, the smartest people went to physics, chemistry, and informatics, today some of the smartest people are studying society using quantitative computational tools. And this is some of these fields. I mean, you may be familiar with some of them, but not all of them. So we range right from web science and social computing to digital arts history, computer vision, and so on. And the amount of this research generated in the last 10 years is really amazing, right? So you go to Google Scholar and you type with a data set to only find articles which actually work with data, and you find over 300,000 articles, and even if this result is incorrect, even if it's only 50,000 to 60,000, it's still a lot. Now, when you start looking at more specialized topics, such as aesthetic computing, so it's the area which emerges around 2006. So the idea is to create mathematical computational models which can use features of images, brightness, color, saturation, shapes, lines, regions, to predict which images people find more interesting, right, more original, more unique, and more memorable. And all these terms now have mathematical definition, and you already find like 30,000 papers just about this topic. And this is one of my favorite papers. It's the first author is a brilliant young female computer scientist who's now working at Yahoo London, and we've been collaborating with her for the last few months, Miriam Reddy. And it's a paper we published last year called 6 Seconds of Sound and Vision, Creativity in Microvideos, where we try to use computational models to predict which short videos people find more creative, right? So we put these videos on Crowdflower, which is a kind of a better crowdsourcing platform than Amazon, but also Postmore. And we ask people to rate thousands of these videos in terms of what we find creative. And then we go and we extract dozens of visual features from every video, right? For example, filmmaking techniques, does a video have loop? what kind of movement, is there stop motion, compositional properties, right, visual effects, audio effect, right? And then all this goes in a computational model, you know, and we get relatively high, right? Relatively high, I mean relatively nice for first attempt at predictions, where we can predict which videos people find more creative with 60 to 70% accuracy. But what's more importantly, right, when you do this research, it gives you some insights, right, how does potentially the brain works in terms of which characteristics of videos people are responsible for people's judgments of creativity. Is it composition, is it color, is it movement, is it audio, and so on, right? Now, before I start showing you a variety of projects from my lab, you know, a bit of media theory. So you all know about Marshall McLuhan, right, and his famous kind of statement that medium is the message. So what McLuhan meant is that the mediums are not just transparent videos into reality, but each medium kind of has its own message, right? Each medium kind of foregrounds some techniques, right? And our techniques become more difficult, right? So for example, you know, the linear perspective introducing Renaissance, right? You see a world organized, you know, in a very symmetrically for single eye, right? But you lose, let's say, our geometric information, right? With film also, film photography also follows this one-point linear perspective. So I've been thinking over the years that user-generated content, yes, it's a message, we can find out what people like, what we photograph, what we think, but it's not a transparent message, right? So Instagram, Pinterest, Facebook, and so on, they are your own mediums. So just as, you know, cinema is a medium, or 4K video is a medium, Facebook is also a medium, okay? So this is my, you know, very schematic little scheme, right? So in the study of visual social media, I mean, what can we get out of it? Well, there's a surface message, right? What do people who use social networks say, do capture? So for example, we can use computer vision to automatically find out the, you know, percentage of selfies, portraits, still lives, and so on. But then, of course, you know, people pose, right? People construct their messages just as in everyday life. You construct what you wear, right? You project particular identity. Right, some people, you know, in New York, we want to enter high society, and they get tutors to get themselves a British accent, you know. So when you get better tables in restaurants on the Upper East Side, so we can say, well, maybe what we really need to do is try to reconstruct the depth message, which is what do people really say, really do, and how we really live, right? So when I find some beautiful photographs from young, you know, young high school students in Siberia, who post, you know, countless photos of Cosmo magazine drinking cappuccino. Yes, we do it, but probably not all the time, right? Now, as I said, things, for example, a platform like Instagram, right? It's not just a transparent medium, it's also a message. So we can think of Instagram as a particular example of digital photography, which, and photography, you know, because we use mobile phones, which have particular cameras, particular controls, particular lenses, particular chips, there are certain techniques, there are certain conventions, there are certain image controls. So for example, it's very easy to, let's say, change the contrast, right? It's also very easy to apply filters. If you want to use some other techniques, you have to go to Photoshop. But we can also say with Instagram, for example, and this specific thing applies to our social media, it's its own visual narrative and network media platform, right? So the kind of photography you find on Instagram is different from amateur or professional photography, let's say, you know, which you would find 10 years ago or 100 years ago in people's photo books, or in magazines, right? So the medium is the message in that sense, but each medium adds its own message to what you're trying to say. So interesting questions we can ask, right, about visual social media. So you guys, you know very well about, you know, top, you know, 4K content, and you're producing this amazing content, and you kind of follow what happens at the various research institutes. So what happens, for example, on Instagram and Twitter, right? How do we actually find out what these billions of people share? I mean, you can't just simply look on your Instagram, right, on your phone, and figure it out. So just to be able to see what's going on, right, in these billions and trillions of images and videos, we actually have to use computational tools, simply to see what's where. So the questions, you know, which I was interested in asking for the last 7 years, so what kind of images people, in video people share and capture? How do we edit them, right? For example, what filters are most popular? Does it differ from country to country? What is the content? What techniques? What are patterns? What is typical? What is outlier?
how does the social media photography changes over time? So Facebook last year released a data set of 100 million images from Flickr from 2004 until 2014. So now we're trying to see, we can see how the images change over this time. Did they become brighter? Did they become more saturated? Does the content change? What are the communities and what are the audiences? Now, just to remind you, right, that in the history of audiovisual media, in the last 200 years, there has been many introductions of new technologies, and in many cases, with introduction of new technologies, have really changed what people are saying and how they're saying it. So this is a cover of a Soviet magazine called Journalist. I mean, talking about data journalism from 1930. And it has a photograph, right, by famous early Soviet photographer Rodchenko of, let's say, the most revolutionary gadget of 1920s, which is the Leica camera, right? So the camera is very small. The camera is positioned next to another tool, right, used by journalists then and now, which is, you know, a notepad. And this Leica, you know, which was really small, kind of really changed the aesthetics in the legacy of photography, allowing people like Rodchenko to start photographing from unusual angles, right? He can get behind, he can get around people and so on. And this led to the whole aesthetics of photography in Russia, Germany, and other European countries, which was called New Vision. So we can ask, for example, how does the Instagram application, does it generate its own aesthetics? Like, right, what are the characteristics of Instagram medium? Now, what is interesting is that today, for the first time, we can study these questions, right, on a mass scale, because we can actually find information about how people edit photographs, right, millions of people. So here's a board from Pinterest, one of many, which posts images with descriptions of exactly what adjustments were made for every image. So now I will show you, right, a variety of sort of findings and also research projects from our lab from the last, you know, few years. We're actually trying to go and ask some of these questions. So what we're working right now is for our latest project, we downloaded 150,000 Instagram images, which we shared during 1 week in the center of London. And we ask a very basic question, which I think will be very interesting to this community. So how many images are more casual? Just somebody snaps a picture, but doesn't really understand about composition, contrast, and so on. Images which are more professional, where people kind of know what we're doing, and then images which are called design, which are highly stylized, highly stylized images, which are as good as what you see, like in the best magazines. So, okay, this is very preliminary, but according to our count, it's 80%, 11%, 9%. So this tells you, right, that 20% of Instagram images, at least in London, people are actually doing very professional work. So if you multiply it by 80 million images per day, right, that's a huge community of professional photographers. And this is the examples, right? That's what I call casual, right? Or very kind of amateur photography. So the person like really doesn't know about rule of thirds, right? Doesn't really think about contrast. But you know, it does the job. This is what I call professional, meaning it's not like the most professional photography you will see like in Cosmo, you know, or USA Today, but the person kind of thinks about composition, the person thinks about color, right? So if you just maybe change the contrast, it's actually going to be really good, right? So I would say personally knows what he or she is doing, and that's what I call design, right? Where this is very stylized, right? Filters applied, other controls applied to create something which is much more graphic as opposed to a simple photograph. Now, the way people who know what we're doing construct their Instagram aesthetics is not only by just taking editing and spending hours in Photoshop or spending hours just to taking hundreds of photographs of the same scene, let's say with the same spread, but we also adjust it by sequencing, right? So on the left, you have an example of what I would call, you know, all kind of semi-professional photographer. Meaning, many photographs are good quality, very visually interesting, there is a good contrast, but there is no attempt to sequence them. So the sequence, right, which is Instagram gallery, doesn't really contribute to creating a strong aesthetic impression. Right? On the right, you have one of numerous, what I would call designed, Instagram galleries from a teenager somewhere in Siberia, you know, like a teenage high school student, where the images are amazing, And she develops a very consistent visual style, right? And she also kind of various photographs, you know, from cityscapes to still lives and so on, right? So it was an attempt not only to design every photograph, but this design and aesthetic is applied like a professional, let's say, filmmaker, like a professional film editor, to a whole gallery. Okay. So now one of the questions we ask, so how do people represent themselves on social media, right? I mean, we all think that, that Instagram is all about selfies. Turns out selfies are actually only 2-5%. And are there cultural differences between selfies, portraits, and so on? So this is the latest project we released last Monday. It's shown in the exhibition Big Bang Data at Somerset House in London. And it's an update of our February 2014 project, Selfie City, where we have already analyzed 3,200 selfies, which we collected from 5 global cities, and now we edit London because it was a commission. Okay, so first I'll show you a video which was done last year, and then I'll show you our latest findings about London. Oh, sorry, it doesn't want to play. Oh, maybe I don't know what to play. Here we go. Selfiecity.net, and you can go yourself and interactively explore this whole data set to see young selfies, old selfies, people who turn their head, and compare patterns across cities. So this you can even do it in your mobile phone that I discovered last night, right? But it works better than tablet or laptop. Now this was a collaboration between my lab, Murdad Izdani, who is here in the audience, who was our data scientist for 2 years, an amazing guy, and also fantastic professional visualization designers, including one of the top people in this field, Moritz Stefaner. And last year, the project got a gold award in the competition for best visualization project of 2014. So what we did this year is we edited Twitter. So last year we also got a grant from Twitter, and Twitter gave us all the images which we publicly shared on Twitter for 4 years. It's a big number. So this is about 3.5 million images which we shared on Twitter only, right, in London over 2 years. And then we can focus more on Instagram. So as I said, we collected 150,000 Instagram images, which we shared in London over 1 week. It was actually the first week in September, right? And this is one of our visualizations, which basically, right? So white kind of shows you photos per day. And then the other colors, right, show you how many photos per day we faces. So what we found out is that in fact, I mean, you would think that people would photograph themselves a lot, right? Next to famous tourist landmarks, like next to famous tourist monuments. So what we actually found when people photograph each other, or maybe there are two faces, we actually like to find some quiet, intimate parts of London. So it's an example how everything you think about social media turns out to be maybe not correct when you actually start looking at the data. So this is, you know, the similar demographics visualization, which you already saw. And then this is graphs I just made by the day in R. So this is comparing, right, six cities, using the estimates from both Mechanical Turk and from a kind of computer vision face recognition software. So for example, we can see here how the green line, which is London, right, is really kind of placed a bit to the right. So the London on the average has the oldest selfies, right? Whereas for example, in a place like Bangkok has the youngest. You also see that the distribution has these two peaks, right, which is very interesting. So, you know, I'm like, sometimes I'm very naive. So I showed it to my wife. I said, honey, what's going on? And my wife, like, she doesn't use computers at all. She's a composer from Seoul. But she's like very smart. She said, of course, darling. People take lots of selfies, and when we go to college, and when it drops. And when you graduate, and when you have a speak after 23, right? It's like, you know, amazing. And then this is, so then the face recognition software also measured seven emotions, right? And this is comparison of emotion scores. Now, zero doesn't mean that you're miserable. Zero basically means that, you know, you don't express like overall happiness. And again, you can see with London, right, where less people who like really show that they're happy, and more people who really show that they're not happy. And then, of course, Bangkok is a bit opposite, right? Now, this is also very interesting. So we use tagging to estimate different rates of selfies and portraits. So what we found in our data set overall were about 26% of selfies and portraits. So by selfie, I mean you're photographing yourself, like it can be one or two people. And by portrait, I mean you're photographing somebody else, right? So somebody else takes a picture. So the selfies, as you can see, the single person selfie, it's about 2.8%. Multiple person selfie, it's also 2.8%. With portraits, it's about 10 and 10 categories. So again, when mass media thinks talks about Instagram like constant celebrity selfies, that's completely not true. Now, and then you already saw how you can use Selfie Exploratory, which is our interactive app. And here, you know, I'm just showing you some of things you can do. So here I selected London selfies, which have like very straight, right, straight angle where people looking straight at you, or more straight at you. You know, very serious, you know, because it's London. All right. I'm not going to show images from New York because it's just like...